The human brain, one of the most complex mechanisms in the universe. The brain is entrusted with the regulation of a number of functions, from the releasing of enzymes in the body to the regulation of the heart, from the conceiving of dreams to the monitoring of motor movements. The list is virtually endless. We can say that the brain acts like a pilot and navigator of the whole body. Any ailment affects the complete body, and if it is a brain disease, then it might damage some parts of the body, maybe irreversibly. This makes the job of a neurospecialist even more demanding, as he cannot afford to make the slightest error of judgment, since it may cost the patient his life. For the removal of the cause in some cases of brain diseases, doctors perform brain operation. For decades, doctors are performing brain surgeries rather elaborately. They cut open the skull to perform the procedure. Though this helps the patient, but it makes the patient stay longer in the hospital. Moreover, the patient requires a lot of post-operative care to recover from the pain and trauma of the surgery. Over the last few years, a new technique of surgery has come to the rescue of the patients, where doctors can perform the complete operation through a very small opening of the skull or without opening the skull at all. The overall goal of these advances is to reduce the pain and discomfort of neurological operations without compromising on the patient's safety. But what are the complications where one can make use of endoscopic surgery?
It all started with a disease called hydrocephalus, in which a lot of fluid collects inside the brain. We all have fluid, but some children and some patients have excess fluid because of blockage of the outflow path of this fluid, which we call CSF, cerebrospinal fluid. The earlier surgery for this used to be a shunt operation, in which a tube is passed into the brain and that tube goes right into the abdomen over here, and through which the excess fluid is drained out. Now, shunt is a mechanical device which keeps getting blocked or displaced or infected. So many children in 10 years time, they end up to undergo 15, 20 operations. So we were not very happy with that. So we started using endoscopy in this. We means all the neurosurgeons around the world. And using endoscopy, we make a new bypass within the brain. And that is quite successful. So it all started with that. But now we are also using endoscopy for evacuating large blood clots. Brain hemorrhage patients have very large clots, and through a very small opening we can evacuate that clot. We are using it for repairing blood vessels in the depth. We are using it for removing tumors. We are also using it for many other complex operations which were not possible using standard microsurgical techniques.
The doctor's main stress is always on the elimination of the disease. And in a surgical procedure, doctors practically remove the cause from the body. Brain surgery gives no chance for speculation. In the endoscopic surgery, where the incision made is very small, how does the doctor make sure of the surgical accuracy of the whole procedure?
Endoscope is a small device which delivers a lot of bright light into the cranial cavity, which is where we do all our surgeries. Because of that availability of light, we can see a lot of structures very safely. Earlier, in a routine surgery or a microsurgery, we have to make a large opening in the skull just to deliver light. But because of this endoscope, the light can be delivered inside the skull through a very small opening.
Technical progress in any field targets the consumer as the main beneficiary of the new process. This is more true in case of the advancement in the field of medical science, as these new technologies have a direct impact on the betterment of the patient. Here one wonders, with endoscopic neurosurgery, what advantages do patients have?
The advantages are obvious. We make a very small cut, the patient has a very small incision, which is cosmetically very good. The patient has much less pain, because all the pain and discomfort of operations come from the muscles and the subcutaneous tissues. Now, since we are reducing that incision to less than 10%, like I'll give you an example. Normally we will make a large cut like this for a standard operation. Here we'll just make a small incision in the eyebrow, which is neither seen by anybody outside, nor is it cutting much muscle. So through that incision, we're able to do the operation. And so it's a comfortable surgery for the patient from point of view of pain and discomfort and a short hospital stay. And it's very comfortable for the surgeon because he's seeing everything and he's in control of everything in that case.
Country of the Golden Sparrow. India has been famous around the world for spices and herbs since ancient times. She is blessed with a variety of climatic zones, a large number of soil conditions, and different altitudes and latitudes. This variety in the Indian subcontinent has contributed a great deal in the growth and flowering of a variety of plants, which you would see practically nowhere else on the earth. Many of these plants have been known to possess medicinal properties. This makes their use suitable in the treatment of various ailments. This technique of using the locally available material has been successfully utilized since ages in this country. Thus, folk medicine is established due to the results it produces on the body and the relief it provides to the sick. Mr. T.V. Sai Ram, a botany graduate, is a great follower of folk medicine. He has travelled across the country to collect different processes of making folk medicines.
I have covered the breadth and length of this subcontinent. I have practically visited so many villages and so many remote areas away from Delhi. And I have interacted with ordinary people. Who are having rural background or even sometimes tribal background, and from whom I have learnt a lot about plants and spices. The rural areas and the tribal areas, which are remote to civilizations, have their own medicinal system. They are all simple medicines. They are all available from local resources. And they are all available and they are all prepared in a very simple fashion. There is no elaborate equipment and there is no sophistication about.
Even after more than 50 years of independence, there is only one doctor for more than 2,000 people in the country. In villages, people have to travel long distances to get medical help. This situation has led to the development of the folk medicine. These remedies are being passed on from one generation to the next by way of their application or by way of their use. However, how do these herbs provide relief to a person?
The best part of these household medicines is that it is not based on any analytical diagnosis. Or it is just not based on an analytical understanding of the chemical and other pharmacological composition of the spices. It is simply based on intuitive understandings. What is needed for a particular child or for a particular person at a particular time, that is the only criterion.
Mr. Sai Ram has visited a number of places. He has collected his experiences in a few books. From his book, Home Remedies, he shares a process where ginger is used for the elimination of back pain.
It is for those people who have backache. And I think, you know, in the modern type of living and particularly with the use of computers and all that, people have defective standing and sitting postures. We have this problem of backache with everybody. So those people who have backache can profitably use this ginger. You take this piece of ginger, a fresh and healthy piece of ginger, and see to it that you remove the external portion, external skin of the ginger. Then after removing this external portion, You just put it in a blender and then make a pulp out of it. You can add little water. When you make a little bit of pulp, then you slightly warm that pulp and then you apply on the back of the person. You smear it on the back. Then along with this, you have a bit of warmed eucalyptus oil, which is available in the market. So after warming the eucalyptus oil, you also give a coating or application on the back of the person. Now, once you finish it, and then see that how it works on you.
Back pain is the second major cause after common cold for consultation with a doctor. We are hopeful that this remedy would help the people a lot. However, if the pain persists, one must consult a qualified medical practitioner.
The silent killer, hepatitis, was discovered by Blumberg in the year 1965. Today, there are over 400 million carriers of this malady all over the world. And in India, it is the fifth largest cause of mortality. Now you have to tell us the name by which hepatitis was originally called and also its various types. Please send in your answers to Director, AVRC, University of Roorkee, Roorkee, 247667. Phone number 01332 85229. Fax 01332 735 60.